You know, the Bible says in John 1:16, of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. Do you know that? Do you believe that? Let's do this.
Your word is living.
That's right.
In my heart.
I hear it daily.
I hear it daily.
Yeah.
In my life.
Took a while.
Took a while to understand.
Duh.
My friend Pastor Biffy and I went to get dresses, and then on our way back we found a jam. I don't know if you guys remember the jam of epic proportions last year on Valentine's Day. We only had an event here, couples dinner with Dr. Dennis Sempeva. We were in a jam for hours.
Yeah.
For hours, it's like, was like two, I mean, like a journey that would take, really, if it's long, like 30 minutes.
It was a jam for hours.
Totally. It took forever. We had to go and pick him at home before we come to Nigeria. We found him sitting in the chair.
All dressed up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, he'd been ready from like 6:30.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Marley K. Shamaza. You are most welcome to this new segment of Business Garage. How are you guys doing today? Do we say Happy Valentine's? Happy Valentine's Day. Happy Sunday. You are most welcome. We are broadcasting live from Nalia today. I am at Worship Harvest Nalia. And today is a special day because Jesus is in this place. I'd like to start by sending special shout outs. You know, the different locations are broadcasting this service live, I'm sure. So shout out to all the locations. Of course, I'll begin with Worship Harvest downtown. Good morning. That's the location I belong to. I hope you guys are doing well. Special shout out to Worship Harvest Gaba Road. They're celebrating their second anniversary today. I know you guys are shouting, you're happy. Woohoo! It's been 2 years. We have Worship Harvest Gayaza, Worship Harvest Entebbe, Worship Harvest many of them, Worship Harvest Katikati, Worship Harvest. There are so many locations. We have broadcasting centers broadcasting live today as well. It's a good day. I don't know if there are people online. We can do online shout outs. Just a reminder, if you'd like to join us, share this link. When I tell people we are live, it has started. Don't wait for 7:30 today. Things have started. Start sharing the link. You can find us live on Facebook right now on the Worship Harvest page, Worship Harvest Ministries. We are live on YouTube. We are live on the website, which is live.worshipharvest.org. So you have all those platforms to check us out. You can just keep switching between all of them. Share one with this friend, then another. Just share the link. Let it go viral. Let it go wild. We shall do a few shout outs a little later, maybe. You guys, I have some good news for you. Do you know what happened? Last week, something incredible happened. Do you know that? Do you want to know what happened last week? Across Worship Harvest locations, we had 5,000 people coming to join us. Across all the Worship Harvest locations. Can you imagine that? Woohoo! I know you're making noise where you are. If you're not shouting, shout. Because that's good news, guys. 5K. So to celebrate that, there was a little party this week. I think you want to see a little something about the party and what happened and celebrate, right? So maybe let's go into that. Just watch a bit of the celebration because this is worth it. And I can see myself on TV, guys.
I was born for this.
Right.
Thank you.
All right, people, that was our 5K celebration, you guys. I hope you're shouting, making noise, because 5K is a big, big, big deal, you guys. So I have someone with me. We call him the Business Apostle. We're going to talk a little bit about business as we get ready to queue into Business Garage. So I want to ask you just one quick question about business before you share your highlight with me. Is that okay? All right. So tell me, you run a business, right? What's the hardest lesson you feel like you've had to learn ever doing business? Like the hardest lesson you feel like, in a few words.
I think business is learning all throughout.
Yeah.
But I think the hardest lesson is about dealing with people, managing people, because I think it's the greatest asset. So I think that's the hardest, one of the hardest things I've learned, and I'm continuing to learn.
Yeah.
Dealing with people, managing people, yes.
Okay. So I'd like you to share with me a quick highlight from last week's Business Garage.
Last week's Business Garage was awesome. We hosted Natalie Bitature.
Yeah.
She told us about Dr. Natalie Bitature. Uh-huh. She told us about her life story, her journey with the business, especially following her parents.
Yeah.
It was awesome. What I picked out, one, was that she was a diligent person, very hardworking despite growing up in a wealthy family, but also she's going out to help people. She's doing social business, which is transforming lives down to the grassroots of all communities that you can think about.
Right.
Some business is stretching from working with corporate people, but also dealing with supporting people at the grassroots.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for
You're welcome.
Looking forward to seeing you at Business Garage later.
Looking forward to see you too at Business Garage.
Yeah. Make sure you guys are sharing the link. We are live on Facebook, we're live on YouTube, and we are live on the website live.worshipharvest.org. That's where you can find us this morning. So share the link widely. Let people know what's going on today. We have another interview that we're going to carry on. So you want to see it, trust me, because it just keeps getting better and better and better. Let me share with you a few of my highlights before we cue into Business Garage. One of the things that stood out for me, you guys, you know how we are in a season of talking about honor, blah, blah, blah. Did you notice that there's so much speed and acceleration in Dr. Natalie's life, because just she's walking in honor, being diligent and faithful with her parents' business. This thing is not for jokes. Like, we gotta take it seriously, man, because wow. And then the other thing is, if your parents have a business, take ownership of it, because it's yours as well. If you want to see it go from generation to generation to generation, don't assume that you're going to take over and inherit it. Like, actually take up responsibility, take the thing, take ownership, make it yours. Like, it's yours. You take over, then your children will take over, and then the rest of the children. Let's have fifth generation businesses in this country. Yeah, I think it's a good idea, man. So it's time for Business Garage now. We're going to get ourselves ready for Business Garage. Maybe I can share with you one more highlight as we get ourselves ready. Another highlight, invest in people as opposed to enabling them. So that thing about not doing what NGOs do and charities, don't just give the people the money, actually invest in them. So you teach them skills, because someone can't unlearn a skill, you can't forget a skill. Like, once you've been taught the skill, you have the skill, you can't unlearn it. So that's a good way to be able to give back. That's a good way to share your skills with people, impart knowledge on them, as opposed to just handing out money, handing out cash. So it is now time for Business Garage, guys. Those were my highlights. We have a special interview this morning as well. You guys want to, I don't know, you just know you want to listen. We are going to learn about the story of Victoria Schools. If you haven't heard of them, you're going to hear about them today. It's time for Business Garage. Prepare yourself, switch off your phone, take away all distractions. Just prepare yourself and get ready. Business Garage is about to happen, and then we have Garage happening later, and another Garage as well, 9 a.m., 11:15 a.m. And we're live on Spirit TV as well, guys. Hi, good morning. All right.
Welcome, welcome. Get up on your feet wherever you are, and let us magnify and make music and exalt our Lord together this morning. Yeah. Woo. Okay, put your hands together. When I was hurting,
freedom to reign. I've got the freedom. I've got the freedom.
Oh, shout it out. Oh, I've got the freedom to reign.
I've got the freedom. I've got the freedom.
Oh, shout it out.
Hey.
Oh, I've got the freedom to reign.
Freedom to sing. Freedom to shout.
Oh, shout it out.
Hey.
Oh, I've got the freedom to reign. To reign. To reign. To reign. To reign. To reign.
Rise to life. give you praise. We thank you today for the marriages in this ministry. We thank you for the marriages in this country. We speak that there'll be peace reigning in our marriages. We speak that there'll be joy reigning in our marriages. We speak that wives will be submissive to their husbands. We speak that husbands will love their wives just the way they love, just the way Christ loves the church. We speak peace into our marriages. We speak, oh God, that for those who are having storms in their marriages, that your peace will come and calm the storm. We speak to those young people who desire marriages, that you bring godly men and women, that they'll marry, oh God, for marriage is your idea. We speak, Lord, that we'll bring up godly offspring to the praise and glory of your name. We thank you, Jesus, for our marriages. We thank you that marriage is your idea. We thank you that you desire that people may see the godly relationship between you and us through our marriages. We speak that our marriages may bring glory and honor to your name, oh God. We speak, oh God, that our children will bring glory and honor to your name in the way they behave, in the way they love you, in the way they serve you, oh God. We worship you. We thank you, oh God, that marriage is your idea and that you're doing something in marriages today. We speak to those who desire peace in their marriages. We speak to those who are struggling, who want to separate and divorce. We speak reconciliation, for you are the God of reconciliation. We speak that on this day there'll be reconciliation, there'll be peace, there'll be joy in marriages, that your name may be glorified, that evil will be restrained, oh God, because of godly marriages. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus, because it's only by your grace. It's only by your grace. It's only because you died on the cross and did not stay there, did not stay in the grave, that we can rejoice and be glad in you today. We bless you. We worship you. We glorify your name, oh God. There is none that's there like you. You are high and lifted up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We worship you. We glorify you. Friends, just join me and lift up your hands. Lift up the name of Jesus. Lift up the name of Jesus. He's worthy. He's awesome. He's glorious. There is none that's there like him. We honor you. We glorify you. We worship you. In Jesus' name.
Oh,
Hallelujah. Death could not contain the power of his love. Friends, welcome to Business Garage. Please welcome your neighbor on my behalf. Give them an elbow, wink at them. Fist bump, bonga them. Friends, you're very welcome, and to our audiences online, welcome to this morning's Business Garage. We are delighted that you're here. Please share the link, share the link, share the link. At this moment, I'd like you to take your seats, ladies and gentlemen, in the studio. And for our friends at home, please make yourself comfortable. I'd like to tell you about myself. My name is Ariho Kamara, and I'm going to be your host this morning. Thank you very much. Thank you, thank you. And I'd like to tell you and people who are joining us for the very first time, if there's anyone in the studio audience who's here for the first time who would like to take note of your visit with us, just put up your hand and people will be right where you are to extend our love to you. And if you're at home and it's your first time, please hit that love button if you're watching on any other, on those social media channels, or send us a message so we can note your presence. Friends, welcome. I'd like to let you know who we are and why we are here. So we are, together, a movement of the gospel, discipleship, and mission. And we are catalyzing spiritual, social, and economic renewal in our immediate communities, and as a result, the world. And we believe that church begins on Monday, and Sunday is garage time. Beep, beep. Yes, Sunday is garage time. We're here to be fueled, energized, and refilled so that we can go out and be church. So friends, once again, I'd like to encourage you to share the link. And for those of you who are in the studio with us and our friends at home, let's keep our eyes on the screen for this week's news. Thank you.
I'm excited, first of all, because it's the Worship Harvest Gavroche's second anniversary today, and I get to be the one to tell you about MCs. But you guys, let me first not talk about the anniversary. Today is Missional Communities. I am here to encourage you, one, to be a part of a missional community, and also to start evangelizing and bringing the harvest into missional communities. Guys, last year at about this time in Worship Harvest, were about 150 missional communities. And today there are 286 missional communities and counting. They increase like this, like mushrooms. At Worship Harvest, Gaba Road, last year, I think were about 3 missional communities, which were like limping. You understand? Like, as in, what is the frontier? What is it? You're not sure. Man, now, we are 8 missional communities at Worship Harvest, Gaba Road, counting active frontiers, engaging in the different zones. People are being accountable. The numbers are growing by the day. It is easy, it is possible, it is doable. Let me share with you 2 stories. So last week I was having a gang meeting where it's an opportunity to disciple young people, right? They meet at my home, we talk, I challenge them, we grow together. And at the end of this teaching, one of the girls approaches me, the young lady, and says, "You know what? For some reason, I feel convicted to start a missional community. She lives somewhere in Munyonyo Salama, that side. What does hinder thee? Start!" So I sat down with her for a few minutes after gang, quickly like this, told her in missional communities, we pray together, we play together, we eat together, we grow together, and then we go on mission together. I tell you what, the next day, Wednesday, she started the missional community in her home area. There were 5 people, they had popcorn. With the teenagers, you know, now we have teenagers and counting in Worship Harvest, Gaba Road. Those teenagers, we challenge them to then go out with the missional community, Incredibles, and start to collect teenagers in the area. Get a group of young people. Let's start to get creative together. Let's create a momentum for the teenagers, Gaba. We have, who can I go with? Go out and do something. Because remember, it's a missional community. So there has to be an aspect of mission. At the same time, an aspect of community, family. We have such an open heaven now on this thing called evangelism. I mean, just go out, 1 salvation per MC per week, as in you guys, you are 30 people. You can't bring 1 person, of course you can. So, do this evangelism thing. invite that person. Follow them up. Encourage one another. Don't go out alone. Go together. Let's do this thing. Join a missional community. It is the life of Worship Harvest. It is. I look forward to hearing that more people are joined. We look forward to more MCs. You are the person I'm talking to. You are the leader for the next missional community in Worship Harvest. God bless you and bye. Worship Harvest God is 2 years old. Yeah, it had to sneak to me. Bye.
Join a missional community. That is where church is happening. Friends, I'd like to welcome us to give. We have an opportunity to give again. We have an opportunity to be a blessing because we are blessed to be a blessing. If you'd like to give, our mobile money numbers are 0778-618-418. I'll say that again, 0778-618-418. We also have 0758-618-418, 0758-618-418. And if you'd like to give by Momo Pay, the Momo Pay number, MTN, is 148-722. And if you'd like to use Airtel Pay, the number is 116-0032. You can also give on our website, worshipharvest.org/give. And you can also write a check to Worship Harvest Ministries Limited. We have Absa Bank if you're giving your tithe and offertory. We have Housing Finance Bank, all under Worship Harvest Ministries Limited. Thank you so much.
Drives away your fear. He covers all my shame. My God is always near. Sin has lost the battle by the power of his blood. My hope is unshaken in his name. Our God is stronger. Our God is greater. Our God is with us, he's on our side. We won't be shaken, all our chains are broken. The King of glory is on our side. Power of his blood, my hope.
Dr. Barbara Ofono Buyondo, principal and founder of Victorious Education Services, which began in 1999 with about 30 children and 3 members of staff. This year we celebrate having reached 22 years. The reason Victorious began was the passion I had for children. I discovered that children never had a place where people would tolerate them and people would mistreat children. So Victorious began as a place where children can be loved and to be let to be children, to really grow well. So nurturing is my call. I really love and enjoy nurturing leaders of this generation who are the children and students. Victorious began with 3 members of staff, but to date, we are employing about 536 members of staff. We began with 30 children. Now we have over 4,000 children across 5 campuses. We have had the privilege of educating over 10,000 students in this country, which I'm really proud of, because these children are really nurtured into observing values. They really have values, and when a generation or a country has people that are value-based, then you know we are safe. And that is one of the things we have done in this institution, because Victorious is a God-fearing institution that nurtures a person to live a victorious life. As an institution, we've been able to acquire awards, over 25 awards in these 25 years, because of the excellent work that we have done in this country. We have also grown to be one of the largest primary schools in this country and one of the best kindergartens. For over 3 years, we got the award as the best kindergarten in the country. The future of this school is very bright. We started as a kindergarten, moved to primary, and the branches that we have will move to the secondary schools, tertiary, and eventually the university. But one thing we are going to do is to take the service near to the people, planting more campuses and going to the major towns of this country, which I really believe that the people out there need this service. So we are going to them so that they can enjoy the service.
Welcome to Business Garage this morning. If you've just tuned in, call your friends. Tell them to tune in. Let me tell you today, you do not want to miss the story that we are bringing you. So send the link, share it, invite someone from the bedroom, tell them to sit around, and let's get ready to be absolutely inspired. So please share, 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 share. This is Worship Harvest. Welcome again to Business Garage. My name is B3. Every Sunday morning, we bring you stories, kingdom businesses, Ugandan kingdom businesses that are thriving. We bring you stories to inspire you, to challenge you, and to wake you up to the greatness and potential that God has given us here in our very own nation. And today, I am absolutely privileged. I have to make sure that I say this name correctly, because anytime now, Dr. Come on, I'm interviewing a doctor. I feel good. Dr. Barbara Ofono Buyondo, you are most welcome. Thank you. Yeah. If you didn't watch the intro, the profile is big. The person is humble, extremely humble, but full of so much wisdom. We had a brief session before now, and I'm fired up. I look at the clock, and it's telling me lies, because we have so much that we need to talk about today. So welcome, Dr. Barbara. It's such an honor to have you with us today. I hope your microphone is it's on and perfect. All right, so let's get straight into it. Remember, you can engage with us online. Send us your questions, the one real relevant questions, please, which are going to actually help you to grow and learn something. So we'll start from the very beginning, the story of Victorious Education Services. How and where does this story begin?
Thank you so much. This story begins all the way in 1999. Wow. In 1999, I was at church. At that time,
KPC Church. I used to volunteer in the Sunday school. The Lord spoke to me. These children that you're holding here are okay, but children out are not safe. And I went out to do a research to find out exactly what the Lord was telling me. My heart was really bleeding. So I now started looking for a center where children will be understood, where they will be loved. I'm happy in the audience. I have one of Roxana
was one of
knows
your
my love.
Oh.
She knows my hug. She knows what it means to be loved.
Wow.
So that is something that I really went out to do, because at that time, people in this country would look at children as destructive.
Yep.
When the children are playing, they say children are making noise. Yet when adults are speaking, we are also making noise for them. So I wanted a place where children will be understood, where they will be loved. And that is what I went out to do.
Wow. Some people already, you're getting slaps because this morning you told your children they were shouting. But it's okay. We are going to learn. We are going to get better. So the journey begins then. Then what? Because someone listening to you is thinking maybe all you had everything, all you were needing was a word from the Lord. So the word came, you had all these millions on your account waiting, you had a facility, and you are just walking in disobedience. So the Lord just needed to tell you, please, Dr. Barbara, enter that facility and start educating the children. Is that how the story goes?
You're making me laugh because it is totally the opposite. I had 1 million shillings on me, and I did not have any building. I never had any land. So I asked the Lord, where do I begin? Because he had assured me, you will be victorious because I am able. And that's where the name of the school comes from, Victorious, and the motto, God is able.
Wow.
But what was in my hands, you would really pity me. Because when I went to hire this building, I can say it was a condemned building, but that is what I could afford then. I put up whatever I could. I started with 30 chairs on hire purchase.
No table.
Children would kneel when they are writing on the chair. The time for teaching, they would sit on the chair. Parents knew what I would do because I was in Sunday school. Traffic would come. People would come as I kept telling them I'm in such a place. And I was Teacher Barbara, Auntie Barbara in many people's homes. They really wanted me to teach their children. When they would reach the venue, they say, you know, we love you. You know what to do.
Yeah.
This is good. But so they would go. I thanked God when I got the 30th child. Because we started with 30 children, 3 members of staff, 1 million shillings in a condemned building. But today we are here celebrating 5 campuses, over 4,000 children, over 500 members of staff. I give glory to God.
Yeah. Wow. Oh. Okay, so now you've sort of given us the beginning and where we are now. But I'm sure there's been a journey in between, Dr. Barbara. Earlier on, you told us, tell us a little bit about what you were doing before then, because someone might think, oh, she was teaching Sunday school, so she already had lots of experience with, you know, early childhood. What were you doing? What was your expertise? And what did it take for you to now be able to respond, apart from the obedience of finding a building, starting with what you had, children kneeling to write? For you as the person, did you already have the capacity to do what you needed to do? And what did you have to do to walk in obedience to the thing that God had called you into?
Thank you. Yes, I was a teacher, but I was a secondary school teacher. I had not trained in early childhood at all. By the time I was sharing with my colleagues that I'm going to early childhood, everyone was telling me, Otuswaziza. Everyone is going to think you are a school dropout. working, I also enrolled to do early childhood. Mm. I did a
There had to be qualification. So I think that right there is a word of wisdom for someone, that passion is not enough to position you in the marketplace. And also the word that God has given you is not on its own. You need to build onto that so that it's not unfruitful. So you go and you do this. And of course, I'm very curious about the doctor and where. Because are you a medical doctor?
No, uh-huh. I am not.
Which means to be. So that's also, I'm sure, must be a part of your journey.
Yes.
Where, how did that happen?
Thank you so much. Like, I started after beginning the school, I did early childhood. When we started primary, I had not taught in primary. I had never learned more about primary education. I had to go and study primary education. I wanted to understand the curriculum very well, because for me, clearly, the Lord spoke to me about national curriculum. Mm. So I wanted to understand this curriculum very well. So I had to go and study curriculum. After doing curriculum in education, they do not give you so much on finance, they don't give you so much on management. So I also went to UMI, I did management studies. After that, I needed now to zero on business, because this institution would suffer many times because of my heart. You feel you don't want to tell a parent that bring fees. Because when you tell them, they say, I'm going to leave the child home. And you say, how can the child be left home? Let me teach as I wait. So at one time I was kicked out of issues of money because I was failing the institution. But I also had to go and learn. Mm. So my PhD is in business. Wow. So that I can understand what to do. So I have kept on learning and learning. At the moment, I'm doing a master's in organization leadership, because we have many campuses. We are going to grow to more campuses. So I need to really know how to be organized. One thing I need to tell you, as a vision bearer, you just don't sit back and say, people will do. You need to know what you're doing. Then you will instruct people to do what you think can be done. So there is need for mastery of whatever you are doing.
Meanwhile, on top of that, you are the principal. You continue to work, right?
Yes.
You have a life.
Yes.
I just want you to know I'm also enrolled in School of Practical Business. Like, come on, I have to be enrolled to something to be able to interview Dr. Barbara. You know, that is such a challenge, though, especially for us believers. Sometimes we spiritualize the things that don't need to be spiritualized. Because mastery, right there, mastery. A person who becomes a master then increases capacity. And you know what? Through understanding, you're established. When you understand your field, you become established there as a master player. So I think that's exactly what Dr. Barbara is doing, continuing to grow and learn and become one that can increase the capacity of those around you. But let's now talk about some of the parts of your journey that we're testing. Because you see, your story begins with a word from God.
Yeah.
Which is what many people out there who are watching have also received a word. And maybe they feel like, when I get a word from God, it means everything must run perfectly, smoothly, no challenges. Have you had any challenges on your, I'm sure you have had challenges on your journey the last 20 something years. But the question then is, what are some of the significant challenges you remember that came as a test on the journey of what God had told you to do? Just tell us a little bit of, especially sticking to what God has told you to do, especially when there's a test against that word. Some of the things that you faced as victorious schools and how you came out of them.
Thank you so much. First and foremost, when we started to grow, I needed loans from the bank, but I didn't have any collateral. So, and at that time, I was the proprietor, the board member, everything to myself. So when I went to the bank, they denied me a loan. Yeah. They could not trust in me. But I thank God that I was a member of YSAVE. In fact, I was the first borrower from YSAVE.
Wow. And
YSAVE has a big story of victorious. I really do not wait to talk about it, because encouragement, prayer, technical advice, financial help, you know, all really came out of YSAVE. Now, when I got this money and moved to another place that parents would really appreciate, immediately the building filled. So when they filled, we had now to start looking out for another building. We moved and we were really thriving. At a certain time, I discovered that we had 85% of the parents who were Muslims. And they were very good pairs. Mm. They really sat down, planned very well. And when we bought just a piece of land next to us, they approached me and said, you know, this land, we request that you put a little mosque here so that we can have the prayers here. We'll bring the Haji, I've forgotten the name of the person. They will bring the imam who will be conducting the prayers. So I told them, let me consult the board. But my board was the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hey.
So I went to the Lord and consulted. And clearly he told me, what did I call you to do? Mm. To raise a God-fearing generation. So when the board gave me the answer, I went back to the stakeholders. There were 85% in the institution. And when I told them, the board has said no. I lost many children. 85%, I think 75% went. Wow. And we struggled. We struggled. We almost closed. But each day I would tell the Lord, you called me. I had never thought about this thing. You told me to go and do it. You have assured me that we shall be victorious because you're able. You have moved with me. I consulted you when these people wanted a mosque. You said, no, I'm going to look up to you. Whether the school goes or not, I will look up to you. And it was tough then. But after some time, after a while, the following year, we got 3 times multiplication of the children. That was the other landmark. The other one, I really thank God that I have been able to receive over 25 awards in the 22 years that we have been in existence. But one of these awards came with a privilege.
But can we stop and like laugh just for relief? Didn't you see the way she's talking about it? I've just received some 25 awards in the last 22 years. Some of us have been in existence for... And how many? Yeah, so let's stop for a moment and appreciate that right there. And honor the Lord for that right there. Come on. Okay.
Glory be to God. Now, I go to Europe. These people took me to Europe, fully sponsored, to meet investors so that I can pitch for them, because our dream is to really go in all the towns of Uganda, is really to take school to the neighborhood. So a school is like real estate. So you find that you need a lot of money for investment. So that's the reason they had taken me to get investors, so that they can put money and we do the plans that we have. So I reach this place, investors are there in the room, I pitch, and one of the investors that they were praying, they were hoping would pick on me, picked on me. And everyone told me, you are lucky. So we planned to meet this investor the following day in the room. When I was talking to him, he banged the table. I don't want this! It was like I had done something wrong to him, and he kept screaming. What was making him scream was the sentence, God is able, on my procure. And he was telling, you have to remove this. And in a soft voice, I replied, I told him, that is our strength. That is who we are. Without God, we are nothing. You can't see anything happen without God. So he canceled. When I went out, these people, other ladies, there were very many people in the hall. They came to me and said, what is it? I explained to them. They told me, just remove the word God. Why don't you remove the word and get the money? Do you know how much you're going to get? All what you need, all your plans are going to be funded. I thanked them. I said, thank you for the advice, but my advice will always be from what the Lord wants me to do. So I missed the money, but I came back with the Lord who owns heaven and earth.
Hey! And did you fail after that?
No, we have not failed.
Exactly. We have not failed. Here we are. Still growing, God has still been able to carry it through. And I think that if you keep hearing these stories, there is so much for us. Because success is going to come. Opportunities are going to show up. You have to decide now, as a business person, a kingdom business person, who is going to have the last word. What you're not willing to give up. What you're not willing to trade. Your birthright for a few dollars here and there, or euros, whatever it may be, because there is a God who owns heaven and earth, and there is no price that we can put on that. But let's talk about COVID. One of the things that you've been very passionate about has been, you know, it's for the education sector. This has been a very trying time. And there are people watching you, especially the ones you're passionate about, the early childhood. Right now, actually, they're still shut down for, it's indefinite. And so, let's talk about COVID. Were you affected in any way? Because people might be watching and saying, it seems this one, she seems so happy. And she's even here talking about education. Maybe she had something happening that we're not aware of. You know, what happened for you as Victorious? And how are you moving forward into the future? That according to the world looks hazy. What do you say to the people, especially in education, who are watching and saying, you know, I'm so discouraged. I don't think this is something I can continue to do. It's not making sense for me.
Thank you so much. COVID affected us as well as all the other people in the world. But education has been the hardest hit. That's what we have been hit. We would be nothing now. Now, when COVID came, what I did, because I discovered I was depressed. I discovered I was helpless. I discovered I didn't know what to do. Because when we were going out for the lockdown, we thought it's 2 weeks, 1 month. But the thing kept on moving, and I didn't know exactly what to do. It is always right to go back to your strength, to your source. I went to the Lord. With the board members, we decided to have time to fast and pray.
Oh, now you have human board members. There's been some growth.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So we decided to pray and ask the Lord for direction. The Lord led us after some time. We would walk, because during that time, it was total lockdown.
Yes.
And yet we had to meet and pray together. So we would meet, would pray. There are those who would even walk 17 kilometers to and fro where they live, because we couldn't drive, we didn't have stickers. So the Lord clearly spoke to us and gave us direction for four things. Say, learning must continue. Look after the enterprise, look after the people, and communicate. In communication, the Lord was also opening the channel for prayer. Pray with the children, pray with the parents, pray with the staff. And at the time when God was telling us learning must continue, that was the time when even they would announce no charging, no school should charge anything. And for us now, we didn't have any income. So we put the teachers together, we went and started translating what we had on paper to put it online. How do we put all that we have online? But God's guidance is amazing. He kept guiding us on what to do and encouraging us. There is this one day when I went to office and I found the leaders of this project in the school. That day the newspaper had written how it is we are not supposed to do anything. And they were so discouraged. I told them, the Lord clearly spoke to us and said, learning must
continue.
We must obey the Lord. Then he will guide us on how to work with the laws of the country. So we continued. For us, our children are learning. We have even the 3-year-old is online learning. Mm. The four-year-old is learning. All the ages are learning. Because for us, we even said we refuse a dead year. Because that time the country was, people were, we should have a dead year. I said, whose child should have a dead year? Do you know what a dead year speaks to the life of a child? The dead year, you're giving a child a statement that you are useless. You are not. When you declare a dead year, what happens to that brain? You will never be able to undo what has been done. Because this is a human being. It's not going in the garage, you've taken your car and they are repairing. But a human being, there is no opportunity. So for us, the Lord really gave us guidance and we started. The parents were not forthcoming. They were saying, you know, we are going to wait till the government. We said, the ones who are on board, please come, because children shouldn't miss. Now, even when kindergarten issues are still pending, parents, do not leave your children home. You are going to destroy a foundation. This building here is great because of the great foundation. Early childhood is the foundation of a human being. If you leave the brain to get stuck for some time, those children's innovation, reasoning will really be affected. So you need to come out of your comfort zone and see that your child's life is really moving on. I also have met some people who have decided to leave the Ugandan curriculum. So this Ugandan curriculum, they are into schools, but they have changed. For me, I can't change because I know my calling. What did the Lord call me to do? If the Lord has called you to do Ugandan curriculum, do it. If he has called, you know, God calls us differently. We have different callings. Just know where you are and do that. There are people who are selling off schools and they want to go into agriculture. If God has called them for that, fine. But let us know where God has called us to do. Let trials not be the one to stop what God wants to do for you in future. There are people I have met who have high blood pressure. We have been hit. But when you take your frustration to the Lord, it's different. You move and people look at you and think, wow. Because for us, with those numbers, you know what would be happening on the accounts. Now, when there are no numbers, the account is also silent. That means you can't meet every need. But what do you do? For me, this time God has taught me to live a day at a time. That is how I am living. And I want to call upon you teachers who are out there saying, this is a wrong profession. God has called us to teach. Let's go and teach. Let's raise a generation for the Lord. Let us do. This is the time for us to go through this valley, but we shall come out of this valley victorious. Woo-hoo! In Jesus' name, because God is able.
Yes, victorious. God is able. You have to have a word. This is the last question I have for you as Pastor Chris comes to wrap this up. What does the future look like for Victorious Schools? What does the future look like? Education services.
Thank you so much. One thing I really want to assure you is issues of values are a very big problem in our world today. But Victorious is a value-based organization. As we really relate with God, we are also asking them to live values. Now, when we raise a generation of people who have values, then the future is secure because they will do the right thing. They will fend the country. They will serve people. They will not look at people as ways of getting money. They will go into these offices and know that God has placed them in the offices to take care of people. So that is something that comforts me, because as we keep channeling out the students from our institution with values, with godliness, they are going out to change the world. The other is, For us, we started with kindergarten, primary. We are moving secondary. We'll go to tertiary where we have vocational. Because I believe so much in skills that God created in us. God created and designed us differently. Yes, I was a secondary teacher. I can teach right from kindergarten to the university. But God has called me to nurture. I really want to see a generation that know what God created them to be, so that they use their DNA. Not that I have seen so and so doing this, that is what I should do, but to serve in the area that God created in them. And when they do that, they will serve with excellence. Yes. They will serve with passion. They will enjoy what they are doing, and you will see a lot of innovations come. So that is what I see in future, that these children, we are helping them to discover who they are. As they discover, they are growing to go to be who God has created them to be, not what the world wants them to be, but to be what God wants them to be, and they will serve the world with excellency. Thank you.
Wow. What an incredible story, and so many challenges for us. Thank you so much, Dr. Barbara, for sharing and pouring your heart. And now over to you, Pastor Chris.
Thank you, Pastor Bithri. Dr. Barbara, you're very welcome. Again, friends, this is another outlier of sorts, a powerful story, a story to encourage us, and a real story. This is not a book. It's a real story that we can see. So thank you so much for sharing your story. As you're speaking, I saw lots of things. I just picked out a few. One, passion. I think everyone has picked out the fact that you're passionate about nurturing children, and you'll do everything possible to do that. So that's very powerful. But on top of that, passion is not enough. You went ahead and skilled yourself. You're already a doctor, you have a PhD, but you're still studying so that you can run your business as well. You went to study so that you can know the skill required for that passion. So it's a very, very important thing, especially for business people. When you want to do something, you don't just go and do it. Find ways of resourcing yourself and improving yourself to be a better person. That's very powerful. Another thing that might have passed us by was the story with YSEV. I remember a time, your story and YSEV were like, you couldn't hear one story without hearing the other. Yeah? And today business people face challenges. That's a story for us. That's a real story to share with, to remind us that we can support ourselves locally, especially financially. Yeah? Because today people run to banks, and banks don't understand you. They don't understand the Ugandan. But if you grow together in savings, like many people are doing now, it can really change your business story. So friends, this is an encouragement for us to continue saving together so that we can support our businesses. Then you refuse to sell your birthright. When people came to you, told you put a mosque or remove God is able, you stuck to the truth and you told the line. Now, I have one question. Here at Harvest Institute, at Worship Harvest, we have what we call Harvest Institute, and we have a School of Practical Business. This week, we learned something very, very powerful. We learned about the future of business. And we learned about what Uganda needs to do in order to be a different country. And really, that's industrializing our nation. But key there was educating our people. That was a very profound thing. In the center of all these things, there was education. So we are competing with global businesses who are using all this kind of technology, the fourth industrial revolution. We need to industrialize now. But then we are not skilled. We have lots of technical institutes where people don't want to go. So we have a big challenge in our education system. What do you think we need to do, you and I and everyone else, to train our children, to nurture our children for the future? Because we might be alienated. Our businesses might not go where they're supposed to go because a child might not be able to repair an electric car, for example. So what do we need in order to skill our people for the future?
Thank you so much, Pastor Chris. A revolution begins with a family. I would really call upon family to begin identifying skills in their children and begin encouraging children to go for skills. Because maybe if a child is in primary seven vacation What skills can they have in senior four, in senior six? And even when they finish university or whatever they have finished, we should always emphasize that our children must have skills. When the family begins to show the children that this is the way, it becomes easy for now the whole country to begin speaking about this. Because we already have technical institutions, but you find that we have been lied to in this country that when you go for skill education, you are a failure. Now, who is going to talk to these people that you are not a failure? The parent. I am today a teacher because my father believed in knowing who I am. I wanted to be a lawyer because I would see lawyers smart. I would see them drive nice cars. But my father, when I was in senior six, he told me, "You choose teaching." I refused. I signed up for law. Results came back. I failed to go for law. I had qualified to go for education. I refused. I told my dad, "Let me repeat." He allowed me to repeat. I got the same marks. And the good thing, I was born again. I knew the Lord was speaking to me. And I told my dad, "You know why I don't want education? It's because I don't want to be poor." Wow. My father told me, "You will never be a poor teacher because it is who you are. That is who you are. Please do it." So I'm just calling the place of the family, the place of churches where people gather. We now need to start educating them that this is the way to go. It's good to have a degree, but you first have your skill. After you have had your skill, skill it up to a degree level if you wish. In fact, I'm really a believer of short courses. Like now, Uganda is an agriculture country. If the person maybe wants to grow matoke, they would go and have a training for 2 weeks and they begin. Yes, education is very important because we need to communicate, we need literacy, and numeracy is important. But the skills is where we need to go because the skill touches your passion. And when you're passionate about what you have, for me, I have been able to study all these things because it is in the area of my call. I may not tell so-and-so to be able to go and study because they may not love it, you see. So they can't say, "I'm going to do like her." No, you go and skill yourself maybe 2 weeks, 1 month, 3 months on what God has called you to do. Skilling is the way to go. Let the family, let the churches begin preaching this. Then from there, we can now go to education and begin mentoring students in their O level, A level, and begin speaking to them. "What do you think you can do? Can you try out this?" And they start doing it. You will see this world change, especially this country.
Wow. I know I have no words. I think that's something that is getting into our heads now.
Yes.
More. It's been spoken to us frequently in the last few days, and I think that's very powerful to close this story like that. Ladies and gentlemen, let's celebrate Dr. Barbara again, and I'll hand over to you, Pastor Bitsy.
Wow, here in the studio there is a standing ovation. This is a powerful, powerful story. Thank you so much, Dr. Barbara. I know that you're watching us online at home and even here in the studio. And let me tell you, the source of everything that Dr. Barbara is talking about is Jesus Christ. It's her relationship with God that has fueled her passion and given her opportunity and even the wisdom to know what to do and when to do it. So if you've never made a decision to make Jesus Lord of your life, I want to give you that opportunity right now. God is able to take your life and give it real meaning, real true meaning beyond the accolades of men, to give you just satisfaction. And I want to invite you right now, wherever you are, why don't you go ahead and do something very simple? Don't allow fear to stop you. Very simple. Just put your hand up. Putting your hand up is saying, "Today I am making a decision to walk in relationship with Jesus Christ." Come on, just put up that hand. Even if you're alone in the room, you're not alone. God is right there with you. Here in the studio audience, if you're here and you've never made Jesus Lord of your life, today is the day. And across all the other locations where we're watching from, business person, you need Jesus. He's the source of wisdom and knowledge. So just put your hand up and pray this simple prayer after me. Say, Lord Jesus, today I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I believe with my heart and I confess with my mouth that you are my Lord. Take my life and do something significant with it. Today, I am born again in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, we know that you are born again. There is a number running on your screen right now. That is 0775-642-4449. Send us a message on that number. The pastoral team will be waiting to get in touch with you, connect you to a real family, help you make sense of what has happened. Welcome to the family of God. Once again, thank you, Dr. Barbara, for gracing this business garage with your incredible story. Next week, we'll be back with another powerful kingdom business story. Don't miss and don't watch alone. And of course, we'll see you later at 9 a.m. for main garage and 11:15 at all your locations or online if you're not able to visit us physically. God bless. See you later. Bye.
Like, you need like another 30 minutes at least.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the privilege.
So, so. It was powerful.